You'll be delighted to hear that I'm going to be talking much less frequently for the rest of the conference. So we're going to let panel chairs run the panels. But there were two people I mentioned last night have arrived since last night. I want to call attention to them. Our board member, David Rumsey, who will be speaking tomorrow, is here. David, can you wave to everybody? He's highly relevant to the conversation we're about to have because his very important map collection has been fully digitized at high resolution in a way that set an example for all libraries. He really blazed a path for all of us. So, and he's on the board of the JCB. I also thank Joe Mizell last night, who is with us now. He wasn't last night, but he was at the Mellon Foundation, which has supported very generously our fellowship program and many fellowship programs around the country. And he's now at Brown University, where he works very closely with the JCB. So we draw on him for both areas of expertise. And Joe, can you wave to us in the back? So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Jordana Dym, the chair of this panel, and thank her for what she's done already. Whoever said that, you've got a job. We also want to remind you that all of these proceedings from now on are being streamed live, so think carefully before you.
Smile, you're on camera. Yeah. Not my favorite thing being streamed live, but I will. For the opportunity, for which I really do thank Ted, the library staff. In particular, I want to highlight two people who have made this possible. I got here, I am a current fellow. I've been delighted to be able to extend the invitation to have a cartographic conversation to so many distinguished and fabulous and interesting and challenging former fellows who come to us from the 1960s to the present, but also really to point to this cartographic conversation and say it's possible in part because of Susan Danforth, the comment Orlena made earlier today about the conversations that you have in hallways that open doors, made a real difference and helped to bring this project to fruition, but also to Leslie Tobias Olson, who I was stunned to realize started as a regular old bibliographer and is now the kind of person who can make maps do, I don't know if I can do it with this sucker. There's a mouse, I'll use the mouse. Do things like this and make the work that we do as scholars really appealing and appetizing to a much more broad public. So this collaboration that came out happened because Margot said to me after I got here, we could really do with a panel on maps. Your project has to do with maps. Could you pull this together? And as I was thinking about it, as some of you know, one of my most recent projects is a book called Mapping Latin America, which is a book that is the fruit of labor of not just myself, but most importantly, Carl Offen, who is a fellow here recently but couldn't be here today, a geographer. So the two of us are interdisciplinary. We're also really committed when we put this volume together to invite scholars from different disciplines, different generations, and different national and international contexts. So the scholars that we thought were really important that folks should learn from were not just people born and raised in the States, but from all sorts of different people who have very different relationships to those maps. And so the push for this particular panel, when they said a panel, I said, but that's five people, and there's got to be more than five people who have done and worked with and engaged with maps here. I'll try and get you an international panel, but how can we get more people involved? So the cartographic conversation has folks who are, as I saw, a lot of Mapping Latin American folks, from Elena Adorno and W. George Lovell, who's here today, and Neil Safier, were fellows, but also folks like Joyce Lorimer, David Rumsey, who you just heard about, Chet Van Duzer, who are in the cartographic conversation, is there really is a rich basis of people who have worked and are working today at the JCB, who have worked with cartography. So a real, first of all, a thanks to bring this whole set of collection of things and the opportunity to start a conversation. We're going to try to be brief enough to have a serious discussion with you to allow the audience to speak. We are conscious of the fact, cognizant that we are the first panel and that the goal is discussion, but you have some fabulous stuff to hear in the meantime. I also wanted to say that, in terms of the personal that I'm here, my postgraduate education, which has benefited enormously from the work of the NEH, I got started in cartography at a seminar at the Newberry Library, funded by the NEH, run by Jim Ackerman on popular cartography, which is where I met Matthew Edney over a decade ago, and projects developed from that. So the NEH has been there all along, both at the JCB and elsewhere. But the other exciting thing for me is that the Atlantic Seminar, which I had the honor of participating in the summer of 2001, a year after graduating with my PhD, introduced me to a series of folks working on Atlantic revolutions, which led to conversations that were fruitful both outside of the cartographic but within the cartographic tradition. And I think a lot of us share this sense that the JCB is part not just of a single research library, but a network of research libraries and of places where we can be both virtually but also, as Rolena was talking about, physically present and able to talk with people we didn't know we were going to meet, but who spark really exciting ideas. So thank you for all for being here. And I just wanted to thank the JCB for thinking about cartography as a field. It worked. Phew. All right, that's my one excitement for the day. This is going to rotate as I speak very briefly. You'll get a sense there have been over 30 folks who have come here. I did sort of what Professor Balin did last night and went through a list of folks who had officially declared themselves interested in mapping cartography, geography when they're here. They've been here since the 60s. And I just wanted to pull to your attention two names in the English language works on the history of cartography. Two names really stand out. The first is Lloyd Brown, who is a fellow here, not quite in the first class, but very soon after, in the first class, 62-63. And J.B. Harley, who was here a little bit later in the mid-60s. And they've been followed, as you'll see, by folks ever since. The 70s was the only era when I couldn't find anybody officially working on maps, so somebody can explain that. But Brown, for those of you who know the history of cartography, his book, The Story of Maps, really took a very broad view of the history of cartography, brought maps technology and makers to the public in the mid-20th century. 20 years later, J.B. Harley, John Brian Harley, convinced a new generation of scholars that the history of cartography could also include the analysis of maps as cultural artifacts, the tools of empire, nation, commerce, or, to put it bluntly, as he did, power. Both of these intellectuals and formidable scholars came through the program here. One had already published his seminal work. One still had to come. And that foundation, again, that interest in cartography that the JCB has had and that I hope Susan Danforth will talk at least briefly about, has been exceptional for some of us who work with maps, who see them not just as documents that are things that stand alone, but as part of books, as part of conversations, as part of back and forth. So the JCB collection is really outstanding for those of us who research in it because the maps are still in the atlases. And there are so many collections where that's not the case, where the fetish is the map itself and not the map as part of that conversation, that's really one of the very special things that I think you'll be hearing about today. So under the guidance of Jeanette D. Black, for whom many of the scholarships of cartographic fellows are named, and Susan Danforth, they've been curators, they've been stewards, and today, the goal is to showcase some of the work that's been inspired directly and indirectly by the map collection at the JCB, open the conversation to you about how we can use these very important sources for our scholarship and our conversations on into a virtual as well as a physical future. So without further ado, let me introduce to you, there are five speakers. What I will be doing is popping up to introduce them. They have, surprisingly, refused to sit at the fabulous tables Margot has arranged because they want to look at the maps the other folks are talking about. So you won't see them up here all the time, but they are here. Susan Danforth, our very first speaker, is assistant librarian for library operations, curator of maps and prints at the John Carter Library, Most, if not all of you, already know her and have benefited from her wisdom. She has published, among other things, a work on a matter of taste, discrimination in 19th century book collecting, and in 2008, and Encountering the New World, 1493 to 1800, in 1991. And again, for those who are watching from afar, go ahead and point your browsers to the online exhibition Map Talk. That she had posted a conversation with maps at the JCB already in 2010. So our first speaker, Susan Danforth, she wanted to start with a blank, so I'm not telling you what she's talking about.
Well, that's good because, you know, it changes. I guess part of the thing is, in preparation for this meeting, and it's so great to see new friends and old friends all together in the same room. And it goes back for me 30 years, which is pretty amazing. But I suppose I've been trying to figure out what I was going to talk about this morning. I put together and then discarded idea after idea. But something happened about 2 weeks ago that said, you know, I think this is the story I want to tell. And I think this is a story that hopefully will focus on all the connections that I find important, connections between dealers, between people, between researchers, scholars, folks who walk in the door, material we just acquire, stuff we've had for a long time, and things we never quite remembered that we had at all. So that's what the second button down. Okay, so that's what might happen if things
it's too blank. No? Second button down.
Hey. Okay. So this is what I decided to call my talk this morning. Now, it begins about 2 weeks ago, as I said, when I got an email from a map dealer, and he said, you know, attached is this map of Rhode Island. It's an engraved map, and he said, I've never seen it before. He said, which is really kind of odd, because you know, engraved maps of New England are pretty well known, especially since Barbara McCorkle's bibliography, New England Mapping, was produced. And so he said, well, would you take a look at it and tell me what you think? So I opened it up and I said, you know, this looks kind of familiar to me. But then I remembered that Matthew Edney, a couple years ago, had done an article and which was called something on the order of printed, not published. And because Matthew was kind enough and smart enough to send us an off-print, and because we were smart enough to catalog it, it was something that I was, in fact, able to get to very easily through Josiah. And basically, it was an article that Matthew had done about a whole selection of maps of New England that were produced in the mid-18th century during the course of a whole series of boundary disputes, which, for those of you who know New England history, boundary disputes were kind of a recreational activity here in New England. And it was the gift that keeps on giving. And so, in this course of these boundaries disputes, maps were engraved to be attached to a lot of the official papers, but they were never actually published, per se. In other words, they were never distributed or sold to the broader public. So very few of these things remain. But what I was able to find was the map that had been sent to me by the map dealer in Matthew's article, and this is the one that we bought 2 weeks ago. And I'm calling it Edney 2, because basically it's the second map that Edney describes in this article that was so much help to me, to help me understand a lot more about the collection that I had known before. So basically something new comes into the collection, and what does it do? It joins up with this map that we acquired in 1952, which is Edney number 4. It also joins this map, which we acquired in 1968, which is Edney number 7. So you can see how the conversation begins to start. But that's not where it ends, because it also joins this map, which arose out of Massachusetts boundary disputes, as I say, the gift that keeps on giving. And this appeared in the Blathwaite Atlas, put together by William Blathwaite in 1683, and which we acquired in 1911. So that's been here a while, too. But it also joins this map, which we acquired somewhere around 1850. It's sort of hard to say at this point. But this was a map that Henry N. Stevens, that I think you heard Bernard Balin mention yesterday, last evening, sort of the voracious vacuum cleaner of a book dealer that was selling to not only John Carter Brown, but other wealthy Americans. Well, what he also did was he supported young scholars without jobs and with good handwriting who were to go into repositories like the Public Record Office and various other places and copy documents before the age of the Xerox machine or even much photography was going on in these institutions. And this is the one of the maps that he had copied in 1845 at the Public Record Office. And this was another boundary map, a Rhode Island map of, yes, another Rhode Island boundary controversy. So this was in 1845, and my guess is it came into the library, excuse me, sometime 1850s, 1860s. As I say, sometimes it's not so easy to tell. But the story doesn't begin, the story doesn't end there at all. Because that very same week, I received a visit from Dr. Peter Schultz, who is in the geology department at Brown. And his specialty is planetary geology. And he's particularly interested in impact geology, the impact of craters and the makeup of the surface of the moon and planets and asteroids. And you're saying, what on earth is this man doing coming into the John Carter Brown Library? Well, after a brief conversation about our mutual respect and admiration for Athanasius Kircher, whose Mundus Subterraneus is one of the first to really explore a lot of geological theory, and I use it a lot for his theories about ocean currents, and he also has a map of the surface of the moon, which is how Peter Schultz got interested, so you can see how these connections between people and materials somehow take place in surprising ways. But the reason he was at the JCB was because a friend of his in optics had asked him to look at an instrument we have. And the instrument, this is the instrument. Now, the JCB doesn't collect instruments, but we received a gift in the 1950s. It was finalized in the 1960s. And we received this gift. And what Schultz's colleague had suggested was that in this instrument, there was perhaps a new breakthrough in optic theory going on. And so he checked it out, and in fact, that was not the case, sad to say. But I started thinking about this instrument, and it was created, built in 1750. By Benjamin King in Newport on the model of Caleb Smith's in London. And it was commissioned by the state of the colony of Rhode Island to do, what do you think? Yet another boundary survey because of another boundary dispute with neighboring Connecticut. But the other thing was, it was also used, it was borrowed by Benjamin West and used to observe the transit of Venus in 1769 in Providence. Pardon me, this is a bad pollen year for me. But now, the fact is that it was built in Newport, created in Newport by Benjamin King. And I began to wonder about Caleb Smith, because Benjamin King had used Caleb Smith's design. So I looked in the catalog again, and what do I come up with? I come up with this book of maps, and it was published by Caleb Smith, and it was a really cutting edge piece, published in 1740, War of Jenkins' Ear. It's a translation of a sort of a Spanish guide, an English translation of a Spanish guide to West Indies ports. And if you take a look at the imprint, it's the editor is Caleb Smith, inventor of the new sea quadrant. That's the publisher. But also in this book, is, bound with it, is his description of his new C quadrant, which is the quadrant that was built by Benjamin Smith in Newport, Benjamin King in Newport, and commissioned by the colony of Rhode Island to do their boundary survey once again. So it seems to me that in this sort of brief story that I shared, it has all the elements of the kinds of things that come together to make the JCV sausage. It's got the new books meeting the old books, creating a conversation which has been aided by the fellows, the researchers who come in, shed new light on material we've had that we've experienced or we've appreciated in one way, but we learned how to appreciate it in new ways. And it makes connections. Who knew that there would be a connection between the map, the boundary map I bought 2 weeks ago, a C quadrant that I hadn't looked at for years and that very few people know is in the library, and a text that the text that I showed you last has been in the library. Probably John Carter Brown bought it. So this is the way that things come together in sometimes very unexpected ways. And you know, sometimes you don't know if it's going to lead to something profitable. Sometimes you don't know whether you're going to get a book at it or really be able to take this to new heights. But it's always an interesting journey. And I thank you all for coming here to journey with us and help us out and help us find out more about what we in fact have here. Thank you again.
Thank you. It makes all of your genealogies of maps and collecting lead one to think, are we classes of JCB alumni or a family of fellows? Do we have to limit ourselves by year? That's a really amazing start. Thank you, Susan, for the metaphor that gets us going in the morning. Somehow. So our next speaker is taking us from the JCB out to the British Empire and wanted me to make sure to let you know that he's been coming to the JCB since 1969-1970. Professor Jack Crowley of the Department of History comes to us from Nova Scotia in Canada, Dalhousie University, and has been a fellow three times, 69-70, 85-86, and most recently in 2001-2002. His most recent book, I'm limiting myself, most of these CVs are very long, but to give you a flavor of what he's done, he's a historian who works with images. And his most recent book, Imperial Landscapes, Britain's Global Visual Culture, 1745 to 1820, published in 2011 by Yale University Press, speaks to, again, a change in the historical profession that he has lived through, where historians have gone not just from text, but to images and now to maps. He's currently at work on the cartographic origins of British Empire. And I cede the floor to Professor Crowley.
The torch is passed to an older generation. I'm also breaking it. I should feel like Rip Van Winkle, but I actually feel like a successful Ponce de Leon. Whenever I come to the JCB, I'm rejuvenated. One of the preconditions for the John Carter Brown Library is European imperialism in the Americas. And the library's great collection of maps is no accident in that regard. Maps and empires go together. For example, Fred Cooper and Jane Burbank's superb Empires in World History starts every section, except one, with imperial maps. There are maps for the Roman, Chinese, Byzantine, Mongol, Habsburg, Ottoman, Spanish, Portuguese, and Russian empires, but none for the British Empire, before the American Revolution. This absence could be surprising, since the British Empire would eventually have a notorious cartographic cliche. So as an Anglo-American historian, I want to know, where was the early modern British Empire? In my more facetious moments, I think mostly in the minds of post-colonial historians, identifying ourselves as the new imperial history, with our hegemonic imperial functions for butterfly collections, Christmas pantomimes, and even landscape art. This apotheosis of Cook, itself an apotheosis of the new imperial history, was a prop in the 1784 Christmas pantomime, Oh My. Imperial can be a default adjective for any British interest or activities overseas. And then I think, surely, more spatial precision and tangibility is available from cartographic resources, such as those with which the JCB abounds. By no coincidence, the John Carter Brown Library holds the strongest early cartographic definition of the English-British Empire overseas, namely the Blathwaite Atlas. 42 years ago, the library published a superb facsimile edition of the Atlas's 48 printed and manuscript maps, most of them collected by William Blathwaite, Secretary to the Lords of Trade and Plantation, for purposes of colonial policy and administration. These maps range to non-English and or supra-Atlantic places like Canada, Chile, Suriname, Brazil, Paraguay, and Bombay. But they concentrated on English plantations in America, both regionally and individually. Blathwaite's crucial map for integrating English plantations spatially was Robert Morden and William Barry's 1673 new map of the English plantations in America, both continent and islands. As an imperial map, it had one shortcoming. It did not identify which of the various places indicated on the map were the British plantations. It was an exercise in question begging, since it only made sense to people like Blathwaite, who already had the geographic answers at their fingertips. Coloring didn't help. Yellow, green, and pink were used interchangeably for French and Spanish, as well as English colonies. The map was more likely to confuse than to focus territorial fantasies of empire. The first published synthesis of British colonial geography, John Oldmixon's 1708 British Empire in America, made it even more difficult to visualize its nominal subject. The three most prominent legends on Herman Mall's 6x8-inch map of North America were parts unknown, Florida, and New Britain, which sounds promising from an imperial standpoint until you realize it's just Labrador. Oldmixon used even smaller maps. These are only a couple of inches square, of varying scales to show isolated colonies. It was really a book about discrete colonies and plantations, not empire. Which should be no surprise, since the only institution dealing comprehensively with the colonies was the Board of Trade and Plantations, not the Board of Trade and Empire. So, when was the British Empire invented cartographically? The best candidate is William Popple's 1733 British Empire in America. It was created at the behest of the Board of Trade. It is 9 by 9 feet in its fullest example. It has an imperial grandeur on that count. It's the main object to see in the map room at the NYPL. And it color-coded, consistently, the territories of Britain, Spain, and France. But the crucial phrase in the map's title was not British Empire, but rather in America, which implied there were realms beyond America that defied coherent cartographic integration, a known unknown. This potential was explicit in Mall's 1720 atlas, The World Described. Mall's map of the king's dominions in North America, with his darling beaver, is very well known, I'm sure, to many of you, most of you probably. But we need to appreciate that the same atlas also included a parallel map of the king's dominions in Germany. To Mall, they showed equal parts of the British Empire. Why the American map is so much better known than the Hanoverian one bears some reflection, perhaps. Let me go back to the notorious Victorian map of the British Empire in 1886. It's seldom noticed that there actually is an inset map here of a much smaller empire in 1786. The inset map encouraged viewers, seems to me, to extrapolate a further century from 1886 and contemplate the global grandeur of the British Empire in 1986. But in 1786, no one felt the need to make such a map, presumably because people were only beginning to apprehend the British Empire globally. Thank you.
You can change all that, right?
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Thank you. Our next speaker, we're going alphabetically now, which also turns out to be our order is the order in which folks have been fellows here, in case you were wondering. It's chronological. Is Matthew Edney, Osher Professor in the History of Cartography and Professor of Geography. So he bears within him the tensions between disciplines. Anthropology and, no less, American and New England Studies. Don't ask. At the University of Southern Maine, and he is currently co-editor for Cartography in the European Enlightenment, volume 4 of the History of Cartography, the set of volumes that pull together scholars from all over the world to deal with cartography from its inception to eventually the present day, that was started by J.B. Harley and Dennis Woodward. And he is also currently the director of the History of Cartography Project at the University of Wisconsin, where he divides his time with USM. Some of you may know him as a refuge from the British Empire, one who started as an India specialist, surveying and boundaries abound. And he's now working, now that sensibly he's located here, on colonial New England. And without further ado, Dr. Matthew Edney.
Thank you. Well, thank you. First question, how do we advance? Second one down. Great, thanks. Thank you to Jordana for organizing this particular panel within this wonderful event overall. So my other thanks has to be to thank the JCB for hosting so many people who have done interesting map stuff for over 50 years now. I would also like to thank the NEH because Division of Preservation and Access has been a major funder of the History of Cartography project. Without them, there would be no project. I also want to show that I have my ironic bookmarks here. They are ironic because on the back is the URL for the online free access to volumes 1 and 2. Which include a lot of stuff on indigenous American cartography in volume 2, book 3. Volume 3 will go online at some point whenever the press feels they've got their profit out of the printed books. And as 4, 5, and 6 proceed, they will be done by 2020, and I can have my life back. the press will also be putting them up online as well at the same site. So there's a bunch of bookmarks. I got a few more postcards. And if you want to know more about the History of Cartography Project, talk to me later. And I'll be more than happy to talk to you about it. So today what I want to do is talk a bit about some historiographic comments. And then I'm going to look at this generic map and look at some of his lessons. Oops. Go back. There we go. So as Jordana noted, Brian Harley was a JCB fellow here in spring of 1966, in which he was exploring some of the sources for the topographical maps that William Faden published in London during the American Revolution. At the same time, starting in the mid-60s and going into the 70s, there were two sort of intellectual moves within geography and cartographic studies. The first is sometimes known as geosophy, the study of geographic knowledge, not so much where is things, but where do people think things are. And the second second move was to develop models of cartographic communication. Academic cartography was desperately trying to justify its existence as an academic discipline. And so they were putting out these models of communication to define what it is that academic cartography is about. But these two moves together led Brian in the 1970s to start to consider the military use of maps. Not just how the maps were made, but how did the military then use maps such as William Faden's of New Jersey, and more generally about map use in 18th century North America. As you said, if we're going to say that maps have had a profound effect on the spatial images of Western peoples, then we need to be able to say, well, which peoples read which kinds of maps, and how were they influenced by them? And so this was in the 60s then, in the early 70s, an initial push towards the study of how maps are used. Alas, the models of cartographic communication, which enshrine the modern cartographic ideal, insisted on privileging the production of maps. They might pay lip service to consumption, but they were still all about the production of maps to determine meaning. And add to this, Jürgen Schultz, who was professor of art history here at Brown, Schultz produced probably the first study in which applied the art history technique of iconography to a map, in this case, the Jacopo de Barbari's stunning six-sheet view of Venice from 1500. And Schultz was one of the first people to actually start talking about there's a difference between factual maps and moralistic maps, but for Schultz and for others, like Harley, this moral aspect was something that was projected by the maker through the image of the map to be consumed by a sort of a rather passive reader. So the result then is an emphasis on how the makers of maps actively shape the meaning of maps, and it gave rise to a phrase that you don't see in print, but I've heard a lot over the years in conversations, that all maps are propaganda maps. As I like to say in public lectures, maps don't show what the world is, they show what the world ought to be in the viewpoint of the makers and the consumers, for that matter. And if maps aren't propaganda maps, then at least they're persuasive. And this idea has shaped a lot of three decades almost, of scholarship about the cultural nature of maps. So here we have the map I want to talk about, which at first sight seems to match this idea that all maps are propagandistic, all maps are propaganda. And I should also note that the JCB's copy was cataloged with remarkable fullness and precision by Jeanette Black. When I first read that catalog record, I was stunned at the detail. For something that's basically just a generic map, it's a genre that you find all over the early Republic, even into the colonial period earlier, of a map that's trying to sell property. It's trying to say, here's property, buy it. If you look at the details on the left, you have a detail of the Waldo patent, Midcoast, Maine, with all the overlaying lines of the different patents, the Plymouth Company patent and the Brown's patent and the Waldo patent, all nicely overlaying. Classic indication of why, as Susan says, boundary disputes are the gift of give on giving. And on the right-hand side is a detail of the edge of one of the two areas of lands. There's a focus of this particular map. I'll come back to that in a minute. And you can see that corner of town number one granted to Colonel Eddy and others has been cropped off in an incredibly artificial manner. No land surveyor would ever have gone out into the field and done that little jig to prevent that township from incurring on the boundaries of the land, the pink land that's for sale. So this is sort of proclaiming there are no legal impediments to the sale of this land. You know, this is good property. You know, there's going to be no problems with it. The plan itself lacks an authority statement. There's no author, there's no publisher, there's no imprint, there's no date. And which is wonderful, because that openness invites me to look closer at this puppy, because it's a wonderful little thing when you start getting into it. Especially because it's assumed to have been produced in Boston somewhere in the late 18th century, 1790, 1780, somewhere around there. But then when you look at it, the quality of the engraving, the precision of the line work and the lettering, this is not done by an 18th century Boston engraver. So who did it? Well, fortuitously, there are some good archives, alas, not here. Philadelphia, for William Bingham's papers. In London, the papers of the Baring Bank, Sir Francis and Alexander Baring in particular, allow us to give a full history of this map, not just the production, but also of the consumption and the circulation of it. And it starts with this thing. This is out of Indiana, the Libby Library. William Bingham, probably one of the most wealthiest members, people in the United States, Philadelphia banker merchant, acquired the option of two separate grants of 1 million acres each, up in the Kennebec, and then over beyond the Penobscot. The guys who developed the options had gone bankrupt, and he bought it for cents on the dollar in January 1793. And very soon thereafter, he had some manuscript maps made, probably by a guy called Charles de Craft in Philadelphia, who made this. And he also had a pamphlet prepared to describe the quality of the lands that he was now trying to sell, because he had the first payments were due on the speculations in Philadelphia, and he'd use the money for that payment to buy this property, and he was facing a cash flow crisis that Donald Trump would only dream about. He needed to offload this stuff quickly. And so the pamphlet was produced in June 1793 in Philadelphia. Even before the printer had been paid for it, Bingham's agent, Major William Jackson, boarded a ship to London with the pamphlets and these manuscripts. And when he gets to London in August, he writes back to Bingham with 2 points. Number one, yes, there is a market for land in the frontier here. People are interested in buying it. And two, I'm now going to go find somebody to engrave the map. And as you go through the monthly updates, you can trace the production of this map. So I know that if this was produced by William Faden, the guy that Brian Hardy was studying, in London for £2,000 in 2008 currency. It was 20 guineas, I think, at the time. And the first impressions were pulled in October 1793. And it was justified by Jackson writing back to Bingham as saying, this is necessary. It is necessary to have a handsome exhibit of the land to try to sell this property to these sophisticated Europeans. The key point, though, as it seems to be a theme in my own work recently. This was not sold in the public marketplace. It was given out by hand by Jackson to the Barings in particular. And we have three copies in the Baring archives in London. These are lousy images, I'm sorry. This is from the 1990s I took these. Three copies that were used and annotated by the Barings at different times in the various negotiations over the nature of this purchase. And in particular, the lower map, you can see this is the main map, and then there's a second piece of paper with a, what's called a backtrack, extending to the devil was the phrase. They didn't know how far it went back. Bingham, in the end, did not exercise his option on this portion. And this was prepared by Alexander Baring when he came to Maine to visit and examine these lands. And he wrote, sent this back to his father, Sir Francis, in London with a long letter. So the Barings ultimately bought this chunk of land, the pink chunk of land, which they then turned around to try to sell to their Dutch collaborators, the Hope and Company. It's all very incestuous. But the key point is, whenever in the documentation the map is referred to, it is always referred to in conjunction with the printed pamphlet, and frequently in conjunction with the manuscript maps as well. So the entire plan then is, in a sense, the plan is a focus of conversation. It was printed to be a document of reference and record. It was used as something to be talked over, annotated, used within negotiations. It was as a printed work, it was a fixed and stable text. And I think this is why it was printed rather than using those manuscripts that were still being circulated. It was fixed and stable because it would enable negotiations. Everyone had the same thing to refer to as they were haggling back and forth with materials over the lands. It restrains the complexity of negotiations. It simplifies things. And it transmits an institutional memory. The content is important in establishing the authority of the map, but the persuasiveness of the map depended not on the image, but on how the map was used within personal and business networks within which it was distributed and within which it was actively read and used. So the lesson from this little otherwise generic map is simply that it's the discursive context, the conversational context, to hit the theme, of consumption is what is important to study. Now, yes, last point. This is a lesson that's well known to anyone who's read in the sociology of texts. And I'm very happy to say that there's a whole bunch of former JCB fellows, Max Edelson, Paul Mapp, Jefferson Lennox, who have taken this lesson on board. They're understanding information as it's being used. But it still runs counter. This argument still runs counter to that knee-jerk reaction of most historians, map historians, general historians, who, guided by the persistent modern cartographic ideal, still emphasize the production of maps to the exclusion of their circulation and consumption. Thank you.
Super. Okay, we will move right along to one of the scholars who's probably come farthest to share her findings with us, Professor Carla Lois of the Consejo Nacional de Investigaciones Científicas y Técnicas, or CONICET, of Buenos Aires and the University of Buenos Aires. Is a scholar who's been fundamental in helping Latin Americanists and Latin Americans bring the history of cartography into the 21st century. She organized the first meeting of the Latin American, Ibero-American Studies of Cartography in Buenos Aires in 2006,
And for those of you interested in the findings of that meeting and one that was co-organized with Hector Mendoza Vargas in Mexico in 2008, the edited volume Historia de la Cartografía de Iberoamérica, Nuevos Caminos, Viejos Problemas, was published in 2009 in Mexico City, and it's become a point of reference for those of us who are interested in Latin America and the history of cartography. She is currently finishing a new book on the geographies of the unknown, Geografías de lo Desconocido, and she's here to remind us that we don't always know what we're talking about when we think about continents. So please welcome Carla Lois.
Good morning. Thanks to Jordana and to all those people who made possible this meeting. I'm really happy to be here and share with you some of my reflections. Like Susan's presentation, mine is also prompted by an accidental finding here. So I will share with you a very quick overview about how I incorporated images to think about a conceptual history, a field that used to, for logical reasons, used to remain limited to words, descriptions, definitions, but I started using images and maps because when I was working here in 2007, my PhD dissertation, and it was about the representation of the Southern Hemisphere in maps and science books during the Renaissance. Incidentally, I found this image. It had been published in a very well-known cosmographical book by Petru Sapiano, Libro de Cosmografía. And it appeared next to a very short text that described four types of lands, basically on morphological characteristics, with some examples. With the exception of continent, which appears like a negative definition, is what is not an island, a peninsula, or an isthmus. But it was not an exception. This image with the text appeared in many other printed books, manuscripts, in many vernacular languages, and also in maps. You can see a detail there. So I realized that scholars during the Renaissance were especially interested in ascribing some of those categories to the New World. So from this starting point, I developed two researches. The first avenue was about how the New World challenged this conceptual framework, how a New World was incorporated in some of those categories. And the second one was about how this conceptual framework continued working over time along the geographical tradition in many different sense, in different contexts. It has been re-signified to explain many other things. For instance, by the beginning of the 19th century, the French geographer Vidal de la Blache explained a sort of Britishness on the basis of its insularity. And he means by that British people were unstable, emotional, and aggressive, fighting with a natural tendency to fight each other. And by opposition, the Frenchness was something like a very stable community and rational people on the basis of the continental status. So that's just an example about the ways that this conceptual framework continued working. So in this presentation, I will be focused just on the first part, how the New World changed this conceptual framework. Because this scheme inspired new questions for images that we all already know, like this one. So very soon, I realized that the representation of the New World appeared in the earliest representation by the beginning of the 16th century, like the continental scheme. And actually, it means that it belonged to the old world. So, but at the same time, there were other representations that shown the America, the New World, like an island. There were many other textual and visual statements that affirmed that it was an island. So I proposed a general tendency in a very schematic simplification, is something like that, to analyze the changing geographical status of the New World during the 16th century. And its impact in theoretical terms. So, but in the middle there were many other, The New World first appeared, considered as a part of the Old World. Later the New World became a part of the Old World, the fourth part of the world, and an island. And finally, the New World became a continent. That is a very, very simplification, because in the middle there were many other representations that were less evident or more ambiguous, like this, where the North America is joined to Asia, but the South America is an island, so this is a sort of contradiction. Other examples where the description put America as an example of island, and also other situations where America doesn't appear in any of those categories. That's an expression of the uncertainties about the geographical status of the New World. Other cases like the Isolario by Benedetto Bordone, where the text especially expresses that they are not sure if the New World is joined to the Old World, our continent, or not. And the map display a very contradictory geography, because the New World is like a continent, according to the scheme, but it's not joined to anything, because Asia is closed. So it's a very uncertain representation. And by the end of the 16th century, I found that the same concepts, island, continent, isthmus, and peninsula, started being used in a different way. So the isthmus made the New World a continent because it joins the two parts. So the Panama isthmus made America as a continent. And this tension in geographical status of the New World prompted a redefinition of the idea of continent with two innovations. First, it has been no longer a negative definition. And second, the continent started to be assumed as a landmass almost completely surrounded by water, which also meant an island. So after that, I realized that those concepts remain very active along the geographical tradition. I continue exploring them, as I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, but it's a topic for the next cartographic conversation. I'm not continuing with that, and just wanted to finalize this, emphasizing that all these reflections have been possible because I had the chance to work here in situ, in the library, with many materials that I didn't expect to find it. And that wonderful possibility brings us to discover many other topics, which in a sense are also new and unexpected worlds. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope those of you who haven't been thinking about maps before today is something that are good to think with and think on, or beginning to appreciate the variety of ways in which the scholars that you're listening to are using maps and have used maps to start engage, change projects on the fly. And our final speaker, and Carla Lois, I'm just going to make a pitch because I'm a Latin Americanist and we all have things that we're worried about and that bother us over times. She came to the JCB in 2006 and 7 and was already a speaker of many languages, but not yet a speaker of English. And so for those of you who only have one language and claim you can't learn to the point where you can wow an audience as an adult, I'm just going to stop there. Our final speaker is Heidi Scott, who is another transnational, transcontinental scholar. She is a current fellow like myself, and I am fortunate to have her here, and started life as a scholar, as a geographer, and might still so define herself, but she's currently working as an assistant professor of history at UMass Amherst. So again, how conversations change and disciplinary methods open themselves up. She is the author of Contested Territory, Mapping Peru in the 16th and 17th Centuries, published by Notre Dame in 2009, and is currently at work on a project on subterranean history here and also on missionary frontiers in colonial Bolivia. And I offer the floor to Heidi Scott.
Right, okay. Well, I'd just like to begin by offering my thanks to Jordana for the invitation to take part in this panel, and also, of course, to the JCB for this wonderful opportunity to spend 2 months researching at the library. In terms of my transition from geography to history, the interesting thing is that I'd never used to work with maps as a geographer, and so now, in my new guise as a historian, I'm catching up for lost time, I guess. So the maps that I'm going to be talking about today are not an accidental find, but are a set of maps that, to me, somewhat inexplicably, have not been discussed in any depth by historians, even though these maps are known about and are referenced in historical works of the missions that I'm interested in. So this isn't a historical map, of course, just to let you know which area of South America I'm talking about. So I'm going to spend my time discussing a small set of maps that show the Mosatenes missions and the surrounding area, and that were made in beginning in 1797 by an individual called Joaquín Revuelta Velarde. Now, Revuelta Velarde, at the time that he made the maps, was the subdelegado of Chulumani district. You can see Chulumani at the bottom center of the map, which belonged at the time to the province of La Paz. In 1790, Franciscan missionaries from La Paz established themselves in the Mosatenes near the Beni River. And again, towards the top of the map, you can see San Francisco de Mosatenes and Mosatenes de Bopis, two of the mission towns that were established. So the missionaries spent several years petitioning Revuelta Velarde to open a pathway from the town of Chulumani to the missions. In 1796, he eventually conceded to this request, and on his return from his path-opening expedition, Revuelta created the maps and also an accompanying written account. So the first of the maps, and I apologize for the slightly blurred quality. If anybody can recommend to me a professional photographer to take pictures in the archives, I'd be very grateful. So the first of these maps shows the location of the missions and also the route that he opened. The second map shows the region or the broader Amazon region within which these missions were located. So we can essentially consider these maps state or official maps in the sense that Revuelta was a crown servant. And given that the collection of geographical data was actually part of his official duties as a subdelegado. To borrow Harley's phrase, we can arguably consider these maps as tools of empire, but as various scholars have shown in recent years, maps are not inherently powerful, nor can it always be assumed that they neatly overlap with the interests of the state, even if they claim to do so. To cite the geographer John Pickles, maps can certainly reinscribe dominant ideologies, but they can also lead at the same time and, I would argue, emerge from entirely different and transgressive directions as opposed to the ones that we would perhaps expect. Historians of Spanish America have recognized, of course, for a long time that the activities of colonial officials not only supported but also undermined the interests of the state, and they've written at length about their involvement in corruption and how this corruption went to the very heart of colonial government. And this is something that I think we perhaps need to think about a little more closely when examining colonial maps such as these. Now, often it's very difficult to reconstruct the broader context in which maps were both made and were deployed and used. But fortunately, in the case of Revuelta, there is actually significant archival material that allows us, if you like, to tell the life story of Revuelta's maps. So let's begin by taking a look at Revuelta's route map, the one that you can see on the slide. We find that he didn't exactly hold back in emphasizing his role as a dedicated servant of the state. His name appears along, you can see here, Revuelta. It appears along the route, and also he mentions his name three times in the title of the map. Now, his cartographic map is very chaotic. Depiction underscores the centrality of the Mocetenes to the systematic colonization of the whole Amazon basin. And in an account that accompanies the maps, he says that Mocetenes were literally at the center of everything. He presented himself too as a producer of authoritative geographical knowledge. And in the map title, he claims to make use of Sobreviela's map of the Ocopa missions, of Aymerich's map, he misspells his name, of the Jesuit missions of Mojos. And in doing so, of course, he's aligning his own cartographic activities with those of these respected authorities. Now, these representations appeared to convince the crown. In 1799, a royal order was issued stating that Revuelta should stay in post for another 5 years and that the mission should be continued. However, in 1798, the missionaries had already abandoned the missions. But there was another reason. In 1797, Revuelta stood accused of a whole series of crimes, the most serious of which involved owing debts of about 13,000 pesos to the royal treasury, debts that allegedly originated in his misuse of tribute monies for his own private profit, and specifically in the coca trade. And he was actually an owner of two coca haciendas in the Yungas, in the lowlands. So whether or not these accusations are true, and they probably were, it's clear that Revuelta was deeply entangled in local politics, in the local economy, and also had powerful enemies who included his superior, the intendant of La Paz. So these entanglements place Revuelta in a very different light from the one that he presents or projects in his cartographic images. Now, between 1801 and 1806, new missions were established among the Mocetenes, this time by Franciscans from Cochabamba province. And a new map of the area was made by Tadeo Henke, the well-known German naturalist. And it's striking how the frontier geographies mapped by Revuelta were overwritten by Henke. Henke claimed that no missionary, and this is just a detail, you can see Mocetenes there at the top, Henke claimed that no missionary had visited this area prior to 1800, even though he also claimed to have read Revuelta's account. Now, Henke was not an impartial observer. He was a close associate of the intendant of Cochabamba, Francisco de Viedma, who had visions of systematically colonizing the tropical lowlands, specifically for the benefit of Cochabamba and its economy. So in this vein, Henke declared that geographical proximity to Cochabamba province meant that Cochabamba had a natural claim to the Mosetenes missions. He didn't make any explicit reference to La Paz or Chulumani, but essentially we can read his statement as a clear rejection of the territorial claims that Revuelta makes in his cartographic representations. Now, there's a final episode to this story, which I just like to very quickly tell. In 1810, Revuelta produced a new version of his topographic map. This one is held in the Lilly Library in Indiana. I should have mentioned, actually, that the other maps which I've shown are in the National Archives in Buenos Aires. So goodness knows how this got to Indiana. At first sight, it appears almost identical to the 1797 map. But a closer look reveals new details. And in particular, we see that in addition to the original path opened by Revuelta in 1797, we see details of a new route that he claimed to have opened in 1809. And you can see this is just a detail showing part of the northerly route, the new one, and also the original 1797 route. So Revuelta, it seems, was instructed by the Crown to resume the abandoned path-opening project and the colonization of the Mosetenes frontier. But the trigger for this new episode, and this is what I find fascinating, was not the Crown, but rather the Mosetenes people. Just a few months after the withdrawal of the Cochabamba missionaries, so in 1806, a delegation of 8 Mosetenes appeared in the town of Chulumani requesting a missionary. Obviously, they were not very happy with the Cochabamba missionaries. So in doing so, they provided the impetus for the reactivation of a missionary project, which had its impulse coming from Chulumani and La Paz. And it also brought about the reincarnation, essentially, of Revuelta's map, the one that we see here. So what can we conclude from all this? Well, first, the story of Mosetenes shows us that the production of what we might term official maps are inextricably connected with the unruly political and economic networks in which all colonial officials participated. Despite the construction of trans-regional or even trans-vice-regal cartographic visions that subordinate local priorities to the service of the Crown, the production, the use, the validation of maps such as the Revueltas were heavily shaped by local and regional interests and rivalries. So in the face of his local entanglements, and in the face of the competition between La Paz and Cochabamba, the Crown's validation of Revuelta's cartographic project actually turned out to be of relatively limited significance. And as we've seen in this final episode of the story, the resuscitation of his map was the product of indigenous agency rather than of royal authority. So what I'd like to suggest is that neither the circumstances that give rise to the creation of these kinds of frontier maps, nor their effects in the world can ever be taken for granted. Thanks.
Are you guys willing to sit at the table now? Okay. So can I open this up to questions and comments and thoughts, contributions, conversation from the audience? We do have 10 minutes before lunch, so. Neil?
Oh.
And for posterity, I think you have to speak into microphones. I'm sorry.
I think that Professor Balin may have left, which may be a good thing or may not be, but in the spirit of adding to this the sense of what the JCB is and its place as a connection between other institutions and other sources and other materials, I was reminded in this panel of an Atlantic history seminar at Harvard in 1999, I believe it was, 1998 or 1999, when Matthew was present, as well as David Woodward, Tom Conley, and several others. And Professor Balin, in his instigating and sometimes sharp way of posing a question, asked, well, what I don't understand is, what is it that these documents tell us that we don't already know? And I thought at the time that that was a question that was just a little bit too harsh for the and not necessarily respectful enough of what these people. But it's interesting because over those past 15 years now, that question has kept coming up to me over and over. As I stared at maps and have been frustrated by maps and trying to squeeze information out of maps. But I think that what's interesting about all of your presentations is precisely that kind of being able to respond to that kind of question in some ways can only happen at a place like the JCB, precisely because it asks us in its very organization about how we put together different kinds of materials. And I guess in the form of a question that I thought I would pose is, in what way in the last 10 to 15 years, I suppose, or even longer, has that conversation evolved between text and image in looking at the specific projects that you guys have worked on? I mean, is it possible to ask the same question that Professor Balin did 15 years ago now, almost, today? What is the status for those of you, all of whom I think work on the relationship between text and cartographic image at the very least? How have we moved on from that question? Where do we sit with that now?
Can I actually ask us to pick up two or three questions so that it comes back once to the panelists? Otherwise, we'll get, I think, a little crazy, if that's all right. So, yeah. And that way you can all get a chance to speak once at however you want to go at the questions.
Cynthia Radding, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and I was a fellow here 2 years ago. I want to thank and congratulate you, all of you, for such really stimulating presentations. And I guess I just wanted to add a little bit on to what Neil had said, thinking about the way you've emphasized the cultural context for map making, the purposes of map making, the consumption, and you've all talked about maps as being part of a conversation. I think that Heidi Scott's presentation, together with all of you, also makes me think, as an historian, that you talked about a critical reading of the cartography, the conditions under which maps are produced and for what purpose. I also see maps as, I would just emphasize to that, maps as part of history, and the different agents, the different interests that provoke the making of maps. Not only the iconographic interpretation, one of the things that struck me was how the rivers were emphasized in those last three maps. What are they trying to say with that? So the iconographic content of the image itself, but I think also we begin to understand these maps in conversation, if we want to put it that way, maps in history together with the documents that surround them.
Is this working? Yeah. I have a question for, my name is Malik.
Can you introduce yourself?
Malik Gotcha, yeah, former fellow. Question for Susan. Susan, I was struck by the motif of maps and boundary disputes, and it occurred to me that since that is the case, one would expect to see maps being collected as part of judicial archives, right, as part of court proceedings. And so I have a question about the larger context of these disputes. Who is actually adjudicating these colonial boundary disputes when it's between colonies? And what is the authority that decides that, and in what archive would such maps be found? And then if it's a dispute within a colony, is it the case that we find maps being collected, assembled in connection with these, with litigation?
Well, I mean, first, I think that Matthew is really the one to answer that because he's the one that wrote the article.
Okay, well.
I would refer that question to him. I think he's much better able to answer.
That's fine.
Than I am.
Okay, take one or two more comments from the floor. Any, or stop there. All right. Yep.
Diane Kriz, History of Art and Architecture Department at Brown here. So my question is sort of a variation on the themes, and thinking about maps as part of history, of course, as things that engage with word and image. And so I'm interested in knowing how much her work depends on what's going on in visual culture, thinking about that kind of larger field that has really exploded in the
yes.
last 10 or 15 years
Absolutely.
As well.
So. One more in the corner, and then we'll.
I think I've got a very loud voice, so it's a problem. Thank you. Mine's just a comment, and it was, again, stimulated by listening to all of the things in the panel. I think. And picking up the last comments about the historical context of maps, that what we're doing now, I think, is not only having our conversations with maps, but I also think we're trying to get at the conversations that the map makers were having themselves with whatever the interest was that produced the map. And that interests me, that the production of a map is not something that's just done in the place where it is produced, that there is an ongoing conversation with whatever the promotional interest may or may not be in that map. So there are several complex conversations that are going on.
Absolutely. All right, so I'll bring it back to the panel and give everybody a minute and 90 seconds to answer these really complicated questions that could take a couple of volumes. All right, Matthew, we'll start at your end of the table.
I think, is this working? Yeah. I'll start with the specific question because that, and then I'll shut up because otherwise all these points, I'll just keep talking for hours and hours and hours. The issue with litigation maps is, yes, the maps are kept with the archives, in the case of Britain, with the Privy Council, and therefore the Board of Trade. And so they generally don't circulate because, they circulate within the archive of and the bureaucracy. And of course, the English administration being so porous with its documentation, copies do bleed out. And so you can trace the movement of maps from official sources into private hands, from private hands into public print. It's a wonderfully complex process. But the key thing is someday I will write that article, Why Maps Are Irrelevant to Colonial Boundary Disputes. And we can talk more about that later.
Actually, the fun was in the arguing, not in the making of the maps, I think, sometimes,
yeah.
Right?
I'd link up Diane and Neil's questions and suggests that maps are a part of visual culture, but a genre within it. And so what you'd want to do is to think about what are the peculiarities of it as a genre, and again, at a particular time and place. And during the time and place that I'm interested in, and the problem I'm addressing, related to the difference between text and images on this question, would be that discussions of the empire in text would be what I would call centripetal. They refer questions back towards the metropolis and what the relationship is between the metropole and the peripheries, colonies, call them what you will. While in the case of maps, the function of maps is both microcosmic. You see things in a much closer detail, as we saw in some of the examples shown today, but also always implicit in a map is that there's somewhere else. There's somewhere farther out there. And the dynamic that's going on, it seems to me, cartographically, in terms of the definition of empires in the 18th century, is that one empire is geographically placed next to another in maps, creating a dialectic of conflict.
Is it my turn? Okay, well, I guess I just want to express a couple of thoughts about the relation between map and text, and perhaps particularly what I see is the importance of having the text, not so much to illuminate any kind of fixed meaning within the map, but in terms of this project that I'm involved in at the minute, and I was fortunate to come across not just a series of maps linked to one another representing this particular missionary frontier, but also a set of documentation that traces the life stories of individuals who were either involved in the creation of those maps or who were connected politically, economically, and in other kinds of ways with those map makers. And so I think the nice thing about, or the crucial thing perhaps, if those texts are available in terms of the light they shed on the maps is that they show how maps can become redeployed in a variety of different ways over time. I'm not sure exactly where I'm going with that, but that was the overwhelming, I suppose, insight that I've, one of the interesting insights that I've gained from this project that I've just begun recently, actually. Being able to construct a continuous or ongoing story about the use of maps, and I'd certainly agree with Matthew Edney that thinking about the effects of maps rather than simply their production is crucial.
Carla?
Just a brief comment about the relationship between images and text. It's a very sensitive aspect in my research. So I'd say that in my case, I found that contradictions between images and text is a very interesting topic that normally is not really attended. And I've been exploring those nonsenses representation, and I think that only comparing text and images and variation is possible to deal with. And about the visual culture, I guess that maps should be included within a visual culture, and not only as maps, but also in dialogue with other images and graphic devices, other schemes, other images that normally are dispreciated, that don't exist, by official maps or serious map or more geographical maps. So I think that it's very important to put in a very broader visual culture with other images, even not scientific images, because maps, I think that maps that not only represent geographic information, but also ideas or concepts or other things like that.
Well, I guess I got the chance to end it up with the curatorial view. And I have to say that just in listening to your questions and all of what's been happening this morning, I'm really so pleased that it has finally gotten around to the point where people are really looking at the map and the text and the dialogue between them. Because, you know, that's been very slow in coming.
And when I first started out 1,000 years ago, and I was, Jeanette Black was brought out of retirement to try to teach me something, actually. Because there was really no way, no place you could go, other than England, I suppose, for any kind of an education that included a cartographic element. And so it was seat of the pants all along. And I worked with her for a couple of months, and we never looked at a map. And I said, well, Jeanette, this is really great, but, you know, when are we going to, you know, do the maps? And she said, you're never going to understand a thing about the maps in this collection until you understand the books. And I sat there and scratched my head, and she was absolutely right. Because, in fact, the conversation, the dialogue between all of these kinds of, and it's one of the things I kind of touched on, you know, in the short presentation this morning, how it's really everything but the kitchen sink has to come together and inform that dialogue. And, you know, one of the things that the JCB never did when it was fashionable was to remove those troublesome, irritating maps from those nice, clean, not, you know, well-behaved books and house them separately, as happened in so many other institutions. And that's why, and you know, that's sort of been the hobby horse I've been riding for pretty much all of my career here, is you keep them together, you keep the conversation going, you keep things in context, you know, whenever you possibly can, because that's really the basis of it all, to my mind. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I actually am going to take the last word from Susan and actually say a thought of my own here, which is one of the questions that comes up with the visual culture and the visual communication and that conversation of map and text for me has been, as a historian, learning a new visual vocabulary, both how to see what I see in the images, but also how to describe them. Because writing about things that the picture says 1,000 words about can be more complicated than saying, here, look at it, but then you can't actually trust your reader to see what you saw. So there, I think, the explosion of images that have happened with the digitization and the accessibility of more and more very high resolution where you can zoom into a detail that did not exist 10 or 20 years ago, where you can voyage virtually to Europe or South America or North America, we also run the risk of knowing more than the folks we're studying. And so there's that challenge of what do I know and what's my visual vocabulary worth with what could they possibly have seen and where am I telling a story that I might be jumping ahead of or not knowing yet? And I think what these papers do or these presentations really do is explain to us why you have to stick to your moment and your context so that you can work out from the source, whether it's text or image, and then play with the much broader picture that you're going to put it in. So again, thank you for starting this conversation with us, and we hope it